Dudes to Dads is a podcast to help men understand and navigate the transition of being a single dude into a family man. How do we make sense of it all? Well, we probably won't be able to, but let's go ahead and have some fun trying. And we are back.
We are back.
I'm Jason Kreidman.
I'm Alan Bush.
And this is Dudes to Dads. So, Alan, we talked right at the end of the last episode about leading by example.
Yeah.
So,
really good segue from the previous episode.
Correct. Yeah. So, there was a couple of tips that came up. And so, after we had finished the last episode, I said, well, hey, the other Alan is here. Those were some excellent tips. Let's do another podcast.
Sure.
So we put together double back-to-back recordings, which makes it a lot easier for us next week.
Exactly. We'll be hearing this next week, but it is this week.
Correct. So the title for this, and this is episode 120. We have our other guest, our other Alan sitting in. Teaching by example, 8 things dads can do to positively influence their child. Okay. So A very common theme we have here is monkey see, monkey do. That phrase comes out a lot. Mm-hmm. And so I think, a lot of the things we talk about, sort of the first element of that or the first tip is leading by example.
Right.
That's kind of hey, if you want them to do this, you got to do it too.
Sure.
You know, that kind of thing.
Yeah.
So we put together a list of 8 things and how you can influence your child by example. Mm-hmm. So the first one, be polite. Well, I guess I can introduce Alan is here again. Hello. Sorry.
Hi.
You're just
yeah, I'm still here. Yeah.
So the first one, this is live. First one, we don't edit this stuff.
Yeah.
First one is be polite.
As you were to our guest.
Totally. Yeah, exactly. Like, you know, I've known him for so long. I forget he's in the room sometimes. You should hear the things he says about me.
All good.
Yeah. Be polite. So they're going to hear you saying, thank you. Please, and also how you talk to them.
Yeah.
You know, that's another thing. We expect them to be really polite to us, and then we're, barking orders at them.
Right.
It's got to be even, it's got to be even.
Well, Alan, you mentioned in the last episode that you and your ex treat each other amicably and politely, I would imagine, in front of your children.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
So you just kind of
in front of your children.
In front of our children, all the time. We're working on our relationship. You go from working on your relationship while you're married to working on your relationship when you're divorced.
Yeah.
You know, it's when you stop working that you get into trouble. But yeah, you have to set that example.
Yeah, right? Sure.
They see it. They're hearing it.
Yeah, they hear it. They understand that.
And also how you treat people in general. So that could be like you're at a restaurant and how you talk to the wait staff or, you're a boss and you're talking to your employees. I mean, all those kinds of interactions with people, they really are paying attention.
My father is very world traveled and he said, manners will get you everywhere.
Yeah.
And that's one of the main reasons why, because you basically, you carve your way in any society as long
as you're polite.
If you're polite.
Right.
Yeah. My mom used to tell me, she still does. She tells me that, that class is something that is innate in a human being, right? That it's not something that you can buy, and that the class expresses itself in the way that you treat the world around you.
Yeah, for sure.
And that,
we did that in unison, by the way. For sure. We said that at the same time.
You for sure did. And that, that it's important, to pass that on to your kids.
Yeah.
That, that the way that you present yourself to the world is the way the world will see you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, absolutely.
That is. Can I use that on an Instagram post?
Sure.
Copyright. Number 2, help others. So, that can be helping family members, helping friends, or even helping your community. Involve them in the process if you can. You know, so not only are they seeing you, that's the most important part, of course, but then they get to participate as well. So that could be, you know, they realize that, you know, you're the person that's helping other members of your family. You know, a neighbor is needing something and you are there to help them. You know, like even in my neighborhood, the neighborhood, everybody's so helpful and friendly. Like, you know, when somebody was in the hospital, everybody made meals like for the family and like, or, you know, their donation of clothes that goes around, or like, you know, it's just like the first thought when you have something or something like you no longer need, it's like, okay, what neighbor could use this?
Oh, right.
You know, yeah. I mean, like that's the thought, because everybody else is so friendly. It kind of causes you to be that way as well.
Yeah.
You know, it's like, I remember, like I was just talking about to my daughter, because it was a neighbor who gave her bike, you know, and she was like, well, you know, when am I going to get a new bike? And I'm like, this bike's perfectly fine. Like, you know, you just got this not that long ago.
Yeah.
But also I was thinking, I was like, okay, when she's done with this, who should we give it to? You know, it's not, oh, we're going to trash it, or, oh, we're, you know, it's like somebody else can use it. And that's one thing. I mean, that's just one example, but really helping other people in need, or just, you know, your friends.
Or even like simple things. Like I know being at the airport and I see a luggage that's way too big for the person just trying to carry it,
or
trying to get it out of the baggage claim. So I'm like, I'll help her.
Helping
out
a lady across the old lady. Across
exactly. That type of the Boy Scoutish thing.
Yeah. Totally. Number three, celebrate diversity. Alan, what do you think about this one?
Well, you know, the thing that our kids learn from us, right, is the way that we split the world into pieces, right? Kids are not born with the ideas of the things that make people different. They learn those from the world as they grow up.
Yeah.
So, you know, celebrating those differences in a positive light, you know, other people's traditions, sharing in those traditions, sharing your own traditions, is so important to normalizing the way that your children see, you know, the world around them. Right.
Yeah.
That that they don't see color until someone points it out, you know, and that it's important to create positive ways of engaging those things so that the experiences that they have with the diverse cultures that we live with are positive ones. And so that they root their initial engagement of those other cultures in positive light.
Yeah.
Yeah. Absolutely.
Yeah. Whether race, religion.
Yeah.
Anything, backgrounds, where somebody's from, you know, anything like that.
Yeah.
And, you know, I think the other thing too is like just sort of taking an interest in other people's cultures or cultural events. You know, there's obviously, like we're in San Diego, there's always, and you're in LA, there's always, you know, various cultural events that you can go to or you can experience. And even if you don't know it yourself, like just to kind of, hey, that's interesting. Let's go learn about that. It's it's funny too, because my kids will come back from, you know, from something at school and they're like, hey, I just learned about XYZ. You know, we need to go, you know, we need to go there. Like all of a sudden my dad, you know, my son wants to go to Egypt. I'm like, all right, let's go to Egypt, you know, like, because he's learning about the pyramids.
Culture's expensive.
Yeah, exactly. He doesn't realize what a flight, you know. But yeah, that celebrating that diversity is an interesting thing. And I think the kids, I think you made the good point, is like the kids today too, even more so, I think, than before, don't even realize that the people are different.
Yeah.
Like they're, it's not even an awareness.
Yeah.
You know, like the way I hear my kids talk, like they don't describe a kid at school based on their color or their, you know what I'm saying? Like they don't, that's not even how they'll engage with the conversation.
Yeah, in some cases, I feel like some of that's being phased out. I wouldn't say it's 100% being phased out. It's both by the people that are raising the children that are helping them.
Yeah,
Not to say you should ignore the differences. It's that you just, like you said, celebrate them. You say, oh, that's interesting. And
yeah, we're all different.
We're all different.
Celebrate that difference.
Going on. Yeah, yeah, exactly. A lot of way to bridge those gaps are through events, like you said, or through food.
Right.
Food's my favorite way to do that is through food.
Music.
Yeah. Music, exactly. Like all those things, you can just experience each other's rich heritage by enjoying something.
Well, I think that's an interesting point, is because, you know, the teaching that like we're all the same, we're not all the same.
No, it's not. You know,
so it's true. Like you're
place.
Like, I think the word of celebrating the diversity makes sense. I mean, it, but it's the idea that you're not seeing people, or I shouldn't say that you're not explaining or judging or doing something because of the way somebody looks or the way that they are or something. It could be talking about the person in general.
Right.
You know, I just know that that's a story like, oh, there was this one guy and he, you know,
Yeah.
Instead of saying like what he looked like.
Right, right.
You know, it's not relevant to the story.
Yeah,
you know, exactly. And so a kid may, it doesn't matter.
Right.
If it's relevant to the story, then okay. But yeah. So yeah, that's something that I think kids nowadays, I would think, at least how I hear my children talk and their friends is different than how when I was a kid.
Right. Exactly. You know? Yeah. Yeah.
I appreciate it. I like it better.
Yeah, you know? For sure.
Number four, be responsible with money. So we had an episode about teaching your kids about money. And I think that that's something that they're watching, you know, the use of credit cards versus cash.
What was that bank thing that you told me? We did an episode. We were doing segments.
Yeah, the spend, share, save.
Yeah, the three different areas where they put their money in. And
until your kids go, hey, Dad, why aren't you saving 33% of your money?
Like, I'll spend it on you, kid.
Yeah, Dad, you don't share 33% of your money. Exactly. You know.
It's different when you're an adult,
right? No, you. But teaching them the responsibility of money, and everybody obviously has a different, you know, different thoughts on money and spending and saving and being smart with it. And that's everybody's decision. But, you know, there are certain things that you can let your kids sort of help them understand. I think, you know, we had a conversation earlier about like they don't even realize like they get so much stuff. That like they don't even like they just ask for everything. I mean, you don't have to give them everything, but what were you commenting on that?
I mean, it's tricky, right? Because you want to give your kids everything, but at the same time, you do want to show them behaviors that they're going to replicate, you know, down the line. So if they see you recklessly spending money and then later on worrying about other things, right? They're going to think that's normal. And so that's where it becomes, you know, tricky. You definitely have to figure out a way to set logical limitations, but sometimes those logical limitations are blurry, right? Like you just made the distinction about, you know, parsing your income in thirds, right? What you keep, what you spend, what you share. We do share some of our income in the form of taxes, right?
Sure.
I mean, so, right. You know, I think we have an out there.
Yeah.
You know, because I think
that's a good way of looking at it.
You know, I think that
okay, I'm not as bad as I thought.
Great, I'm sure. In your
my tax guy is really smart, so I don't pay as much.
But yeah, it's those, you know, it's those behaviors that they are going to replicate, whether you like it or not. So being very cognizant about the way that you engage money, but also, you know, kids at different ages, you can never control the way that they interpret the information you give them. So sometimes if you tell them, no, you know, we're not going to spend this money right now because, you know, we want to make sure we have enough for, you know, the rest of our responsibilities, a kid might interpret that as, oh my God, are we poor?
Well, we had that comment. Instead of saying we can't afford it, it's saying that's not how we choose to spend our money. Mm. That was, I really like that. Scott came in and he said, you know, that's, you don't want to necessarily create the idea of scarcity. Yeah. It's really about the choice. Like I'm choosing to spend our money on our mortgage instead of this, or my rent. That's a much more important to me than water balloons.
Right. You know? Right. Yeah. For
sure. Well, it depends, but yeah, some of those water balloons, have you seen those things? Like, oh, you can fill 100 water balloons at one time.
Yes.
Like, going off topic, but yeah, it's pretty impressive. So number five, express emotion. You know, I think emotions are not good or bad. They just are. That's something that we've learned here. And that in many instances, it's okay for your kids and it's good for your kids to see emotion. Now, I will have take the caveat that it's not always good. You know, there are things that you can be emotional about that might not be good for them to witness. But true emotion, I think if they can put it into context, I can give you an example. Is like recently, I was a little upset, and part of it was that it was the anniversary of my mother's death. And so my kids sensed, like, they can kind of see that I was off and I had a little bit of a tear in my eye or something. And so I was at first was trying to sort of keep it in, like, you know, okay, I'll hold it together until they go to bed and then I'll get, you know, get really upset.
Right.
And then realizing kind of like, what I actually talking to myself, like, there's no reason for this. Like know that it's an important thing for me, that it's an emotional thing. And I'm just, it's okay to have that emotion, you know? And so I actually was like, kind of started crying as I was hugging my son goodnight. And, you know, he was like, oh, what's wrong? And I would just explain, well, I'm sad. I miss my mom. And then my daughter comes in and then it's like, becomes this like crying fest. But it was good. It was healthy. And I said, you know what? Hey, it's, you know, I'm certainly in a better place now than I was, you know, sort of dealing with that emotion. But I said, you know, hey, it's like, we get sad. Like, it's it.
Yeah.
We get sad. Then we say, okay, good. You know, we're done. I'm not sad right now. Right, exactly. You know, and then we talked about something else and we went on. But feeling okay as a dad, as a man, to express that emotion, it's okay. You know, you can be, you know, you can have emotion and still be strong and masculine and everything else. Exactly. It doesn't negate from what you're worried about,
right,
you
know? Right,
or what you're worried other people are going to think. So, it was something I think that expressing that emotion is, you know, they're able to see that it's okay and that's safe to, you know, to have that emotion. And then also how you deal with it. You know, I wasn't getting upset.
Yeah,
you anger,
throwing stuff around the house.
Yeah, it was just like, hey, this is what's going on, and then I'm good. Like, you know, I'm talking about it.
Right.
So, the next one, work hard, number six. So, Alan, I think you had some thoughts on this too, but if, you know, you want something, you're going to need to work for it.
Yeah.
You know, we're sort of taught work ethic, if you will. I mean, you witnessed that too. I mean, your dad was hardworking and, so, and then hard work pays off in the long term.
Yeah.
You know, that's something else.
Well, that, you know, it's going to take work to achieve anything. I think a lot of kids these days, they try something and if they're not good at it right off the bat, they get frustrated and they beat up on themselves. I'm not good.
I was like that with golf.
And they give up, you know, and, you know, teaching them that everything takes practice. That nobody just jumps out of bed one day and are the best tennis player in the world or the best soccer player, you know, or the most talented mathematician, right? Mm-hmm. All of those things.
10,000 hours.
They were, I don't know that even the 10,000 hour thing has been validated yet because there was that guy that was trying to become the professional golfer.
Oh, really?
Yeah. But it's more about instilling a work ethic that is more about understanding that to be good, you need to practice, that you need to put the work in to be good.
If that's what's important to you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But I mean, even as a professional, even as an architect or a designer, you don't get good unless you design.
Right.
Right.
You have to practice.
Although you were talented early on that you knew how to do things, but you know, that's somewhat genetic or something where you have an artistic ability.
Well, yeah. There's ability.
I mean, you had the ability to draw and do those very early on where you're like, okay, I'm going to foster that and then, you know, continue on.
Yeah. But having natural talent does not translate into doing good work. Right.
That's true. A great point. True. And I think that's the thing. Is some
well, natural
that,
talent and work ethic is dangerous. I mean, that's what's really powerful.
Yeah, right. Some people are genetically predisposed to be whatever, strong or smart or, you know,
right.
good
that's
at drawing.
What a professional athlete. I mean, they're genetically gifted in some manner, but they also have extreme work ethic.
Yeah, there's some people I know who are just as fast and or as strong as a football player, for example, but they're not playing professional football.
Right.
Because they didn't put the work into it to actually make it that their reality.
Right. Yeah.
You know,
it's like that dedication.
Yeah.
I
was pretty strong and fast, and I didn't any discipline to become a football.
No, that was for a friend of mine who doesn't think I'm an athlete. No, he's listening. So, so working hard is really important. And then on the balance of that, is enjoying your life. You know, that they're able to see that you do enjoy your life. Now, you know, the work life balance is really different for everybody. So for those who say, you know, well, you have to find work-life balance, but it's very individualized because, you know, people thrive on work. And you know, I can even say for myself as an example, like I really enjoy working. And even like, you know, the parts where sometimes where my time off is still work in a sense, but it's just maybe a different project like this stuff or something that I really enjoy.
Right.
It doesn't necessarily mean that I have to go hiking, you know, or that I have to do something, but I'm not complaining about it, You know, right. I'm not complaining. Oh my gosh, I didn't have the time to go exercise. No, I make the time to exercise if I want to exercise. So I think it has to do with your desire for that and not to contradict yourself. That's the important part. Because like if you really enjoy working all the time, great. But it's where you have that contradiction that becomes difficult.
Mm-hmm. Well, so, yeah. And how does that dovetail into your role as a dad?
Right.
Right. You know, that leading by example thing, right?
Yeah, full circle right there.
Right. Showing them, you know, what's important, what you value. I mean, you do it by example, right? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Working hard, focusing.
Yeah, and that work can be enjoyable. So like if they know as an example that I have like a meetup and they say, oh, like what were you doing? I said, oh, I had a meetup. I was working really, or I was up, you know, I was doing stuff really late. It's so enjoyable. I really, really, you know, and they hear that feedback. It's not, oh, I was up late doing, you know, I had this obligation and I had to do this. Like I already know that I can't complain about what I'm doing because I'm choosing to do it.
Right.
You know, I'm choosing to spend my time that way. Mm-hmm. And so if I'm going to complain about it, I shouldn't be doing it. Like true. That's, yeah. It's very Gary Vee, you know, yeah, like that's yeah. kind of the philosophy. It's like, sure. If you're not complaining, then you're good. Then you won.
Yeah.
But if you are complaining that you don't have time for X, or you're complaining the opposite and saying, I don't have time, or I'm not making enough money or such, but yet you're spending a lot of leisure time. Mm. That's not the right balance for you then.
Right.
You know, so it's gauging that complaint.
Sure. Yeah.
And then the last thing is number 8, taking care of yourself. And I think this means, you know, mind, body, spirit sort of encompasses all those things that, you know, that whether you know, you can practice meditation or you do yoga or you exercise versus, you know, also eating healthy, et cetera. I mean, that, you know, children are going to see that you take care of yourself if that is something that you value. And I think most people value it to a certain extent. It's just to what extent.
Sure.
You know, I mean, nobody wants their kid to have health problems as a result of their, you know, not dieting or, you know, not eating well and, you know, being sedentary. But it doesn't mean you go work out at the gym every day. You know, right. It's kind of whatever your balance is and knowing that you're healthy and that you, you know, take care of yourself and care about yourself.
Yeah. So you would hope at least that that's the thought pattern.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, I can see that this is my opinion. You know, this is my opinion because that's something that's important in my life. There are other people. Yeah, it is. Yeah. I mean, but I know that there's other people that may not be as important.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. I mean, they don't care about the food. You can see it.
That's kind of my point. Yeah. Yeah, exactly.
What do you think about that, Alan?
Yeah. No, you know, I was just, you know, listening to your words and painting pictures in my head based on those. And, you know, it is your behaviors, right? I mean, this is... You know, live a good life.
Yeah.
Live the life that you would hope your kid would live. Would live, right?
Yeah. No, for sure.
You know, that example, those powerful examples, they are what your kid is going to pattern themselves after, either positively or negatively. You have that's the most influence you're ever going to have on your child is the way that you act in front of them. And it's challenging. Nobody does it perfectly. You know, I know that I'm challenged all the time, you know, but, as much as I can be aware and as much as I can mediate and moderate the things that are challenges for me and share them with them so that they hopefully understand a little bit about where some of those frustrations come from sometimes. I think that's good too.
Yeah. And I think, you know, some of these things are very obvious, you know, but sometimes obvious things are what we miss.
Yeah.
You know, because I think we take them for granted. It's sort of, it's very, very interesting. And I think, I was talking to somebody once about they don't exercise, and they said, "Well, I just can't find the motivation." And I said, "Well, what if you knew that your children were watching you, and because they are?" And he actually said, "You know what? That actually would
motivates
change
me.
That would change me." And I said, "And that's so. If you have difficulty with many things of whether it's motivation or such, if you can think of it as saying, hey." What if I do these things to show my child how they need to be done or how they should be done?
Yeah.
Because sometimes we do need that motivation, whether that be, you know, hey, I need to take a little bit more breaks and enjoy myself a little bit more, or hey, I need to, you know, eat better, or I need to exercise, or hey, maybe I need to, like, you know, help the community a little more. And so, you know, and if you start looking at some of those things, that they're going to help you, but they're really going to help your kids see what they should be doing.
Yeah.
You know, and that
and
could
in
be
turn, an, it will help you.
Yeah. And that could be an extra motivator.
Yeah, absolutely.
So if anybody has any ideas or amazing things that they think dads can positively do to influence a child, what should they do? Alan?
Email us at podcast@dudesthedads.com. You should also get a hold of us on Twitter @dudesthedads, Facebook, dudesthedads.com, and then go to YouTube, Stitcher, and or iTunes, Apple Podcasts, whatever it's called now, and subscribe to our channel at Dudes the Dads. You can probably find us at any of those channels. Subscribe, leave a comment, preferably a nice one, and 5 stars at least, and it'll help us grow the network and channel.
We do like optimization, as they call it.
Optimization.
Yeah, get to the top.
Yeah.
Most listened.
That's what it's all about.
Yeah, that's where we're driven, right?
That's our motivation.
Another topic coming up. All right, so with that, Alan, yes. And Alan. Imagine
all right.
If we had a third Alan.
Yeah, I want to have Alan on the show all the time, so you're just surrounded by Alans.
There you go.
I don't know about that. No, but thank you again for sticking around and actually giving us a good topic. I mean, it was sort of this organic thing that, like, I was like, ooh, that was some good, you gave us some good meat.
Yeah.
I appreciate that.
Yeah. So. You know me and
carne
asada.
That's true. No, we have to talk. I just had some over the weekend. So with that, thank you guys. And we will see you next time.
See you next time.
Cheers.